Now I need to make some introductory remarks. These are not my slides. I have taken them off the net, and whoever made the slides has been very kind not even to put his name. So he can't catch me later, which is a matter of relief, but I am still being honest. You see, this is about the use of cameras and vision to accomplish certain things in the context of robotics. Now, there are many things that each sensor can do. Give me any sensor. There are certain things it can do, and there are certain things it cannot do very well. Right? So, that is true also with the camera as a sensor. So, for example, if you are designing a robot to pick up this, we have to understand carefully how this whole thing happens when we do it. It's not as simple as you might think. The fact is that several different sensors come into play even when carrying out a simple task such as keeping this from here, taking it from here and putting it there. And among them, the sequence in which it happens, if we just analyze this particular case, is first we use vision. So, the object is here, we know where our hand is, we have to see where our hand is. It's interesting. Suppose I had this desk and there was one shelf under the desk, and this was kept in the shelf, and I had to grope around looking for it. Even if I knew where it was in the desk, I would really have to feel around like this to find it. That's because knowing where the object is only half of the story. You also have to know where your hand is, and then you have to make them come together by moving the part which is in your control, which is the hand. And when you come, when you bring your hand close to the robot, to the object, then in that process, the primary useful input is vision, because vision is the only sensory mechanism you have that can work without contact. Of course, there are others like smell and you know, things, but you know, they hardly give you any proper sense of direction. There are problems in many ways. Vision is fantastic. I mean, you can see the stars. You can never go there, but you can see them. And you know, more or less accurately, it's not completely accurate, I must tell you, that you get the direction. You don't get the distance, but you get the direction. So this is all about, you know, this all is all in praise of the area I work in. But let me tell you its limitations. I have used vision to bring my hand up to this object. It's a separate question, how do I know amongst all the things I see over here, what is the thing to be picked up? That is the first question. Indeed, today's lecture will be about the first question, how to identify what you want. That is the problem of image segmentation. You see so many things all around you at all times. You cannot choose to see only what you want. In fact, that would be dangerous, because you always need to see many things. I can't just see this, I have to know where is the step also, otherwise it's a problem. So, having identified where the object is and having gone close to it, there is this last bit about holding it and lifting it up. Now, at the moment, I am able to see this rather closely, but you also, some of you can see it. Can you tell me if I am holding it properly enough to lift it? Why? Why is my eye not able to tell me whether I am holding it properly? My eye can tell me whether I am here or here or here, but it cannot tell me whether I am holding it tightly enough, because that is outside the scope of visual sensing. For that, you need contact pressure on your fingers. Only that will convince you how hard you are holding it and make you lift it up like this. If you are not holding it hard enough, you will leave it behind when you take it up. And if you hold it absolutely too hard, you will have to pay for the damages. So, there is the right band of force with which to hold. have to hold it with the minimum range of friction required to make sure you do lift it and make sure you don't crush it. And for that, you must know the approximate weight of the item. You try to lift a jug off the table without knowing how much water is in the jug. You may, for example, think that this jug is full. You lift it with full strength and then it just goes because it was empty. And you didn't know. It looks exactly the same as a full jug. I don't mean a glass jug, of course. I mean a steel jug, where you can't see how much water is inside. So there are very, very simple things you cannot do with your eyes. You have to use this. But that is just a kind of an assessment of some of the limitations of vision. But yet, it is the most incredible thing we have. You can do things with it for a very, very wide range of situations. But today's problem is about identifying what you want to pick up. Out of all the things you see, selecting the object, outlining the object so that you know this is where it is. This, oh, I can pick it up like this. I can't pick it up like this. I have to pick it up. I have to know the contours of the object and pick it up from the two sides. So I have to know the boundaries of the object, the contour of the object. That is the problem of image segmentation, finding the object. More generally, you can say image segmentation is about dividing up the image into different parts. It is. But normally, of those different parts, you are concerned with only one part, the part that you want to pick up or the part that you want to follow or track or whatever. So, what I will go through first are some definitions, and then we will generalize these segmentation questions to things like, can you pick up, can you automatically use segmentation techniques to identify objects of a certain shape? Identify all objects that are there of a certain shape. This is very often done when you want to detect an outlier object. The Japanese apparently, in their desperate lack of manpower, use techniques to detect foreign objects in tea leaves. Dried tea leaves start pouring like a thin curtain, and they have a robot with lot of nozzles. They have a system with lot of nozzles. Wherever they see an object that doesn't look like a tea leaf, they just blow on it and it's thrown out of that thing that's falling down. You can do that with stones in rice, for example. You can take out stones in rice. There's a lot of computation involved. In India, it's really not worth doing it. You pay somebody, they'll do it for you. Human effort is cheaper than building a machine to do that. So, this is the segmentation problem in its various manifestations. One is about finding regions in an image. The other is about finding lines in an image, which is sufficiently interesting in its own right because you have to do it very often. You see, human environments, man-made environments like this one, like this room, you can just look around and see how many straight lines are there. There are lots of natural straight lines to be found. Well, not natural, but well, man-made straight lines. So they are very useful for moving around in man-made environments. Of course, you go out into open space and you hardly see any straight lines. There are hardly any straight lines to be found in natural environments, but that's okay. The third is, as I said, looking for shapes of specific kind. Here is an example of segmentation. As you can see, this is just a tentative attempt at segmentation. You have this boat or sailboat traveling in the water, and you want to have a means of identifying just the boat. So let us say that that problem has been solved by some automatic algorithm, and you have got this green boundary which says this is the boat. Unfortunately, that green boundaries are being drawn in all kinds of places, including in the water. on the two sides of the shadow of that boat, as you can see. This is the problem of automatic methods of image segmentation. It will divide up the image on some technical criteria that you provide for it. You can also see that bridge over there is being ripped up into lots of little segments. Why does it do all these mistakes? It's because the algorithm doesn't know what is a boat. We all know what is a boat, at least many of us know what is a boat. And so if you ask me to do it, I will probably take a pen and just mark out the boundary and say, yeah, this is a boat. Here you see this as divided the sail into a separate part, the main body of the boat into a separate part below. It does these also. It doesn't recognize that they are all part of the same boat. So this is the half-baked level at which image segmentation currently rests. There have been, of course, all kinds of modern neural network based approaches to do this problem, but a guarantee of success is still not available. Okay, this is an example of segmenting or extracting straight lines in a man-made environment like that picture over there. You can see that there are a lot of straight lines to be found. There are a few non-straight places, but well, in this case, we are primarily focusing on straight lines, and you can see that all these straight lines that you can think of in that image have been taken out. Now, how is this also a problem of segmentation? Well, segmentation is about picking up connected regions which satisfy a certain property. Here the connected regions are thin arrays of pixels, which all are collinear. So that's how a straight line also becomes a legitimate subject matter of segmentation. Now here we have all kinds of curves you can see over there, all kinds of outlines and curves, which are characterized only very broadly as curves and lines of various kinds. Even they can be treated as segments of the image, can be called segments of the image, and the task of pulling them out, you can see that they all correspond to boundaries between different parts of the scene over there, come over here. Okay. So, the first kind of segmentation is what I would call what is classically termed segmentation, and that involves taking the image and dividing it into several separate regions using the policy that first of all the regions are connected to each other. You have a path between any two points in one region that travels through the region itself to go to the other point. The second is they should be similar in some way. Now that is something that I don't want to characterize too closely, but similar in some way is very important. If you look at a plant, you've got lots of leaves, then can you say that one leaf is a segment? What is similar about the different parts of one leaf? You can say, oh, they are all green. Whole plant is green. So if you say I am going to pick up all those parts of the image which are green, then you are going to pick up the whole plant, but I want only one leaf, a particular leaf. So what will be specific about a particular leaf? A leaf is a continuous surface, and in normal illumination without shadows and artifacts, it will have a gradually varying shade of green. You move over the leaf. That is all you have, that it is gradually varying. Whereas at the edge of the leaf, when you are looking at some other leaf behind it or in front of it, there will be a discontinuity, a sudden change in the color or in the brightness. That makes it a different object. So, we are now setting up some ground rules about what characterizes a particular segment. It is this. So it is a partition. A partition of any object is defined as cutting it up into non-overlapping parts and making sure that all parts are there. That is a partition. So here you see, they don't intersect and they cover the whole image. Second, each part has a certain level of homogeneity. This is what I think. Similar to each other, the parts that go into one particular region, the pixels that go into one particular region should resemble each other in some way. Finally, they should be sufficiently different from neighboring regions. Okay. However, this criterion that, or this set of criteria that we have set up over here, are they physically meaningful? Physically meaningful is a separate problem. And that's why you should take care to understand that you have some requirements about a certain scene. You want to pick up something. And that something may be a dog, for example, in a picture. You want to pick up a dog. And how do you describe the dog? You have to pick up some property of the appearance of the dog that makes sure that you pick up all pixels which belong to the dog and reject all pixels that don't belong to the dog. What kind of characteristic can that be? It may be that, you know, the dog has hair on it, whereas the surrounding regions around the dog doesn't have hair on it. It could be that the dog is black, the particular dog you are interested in, and the surroundings is white. Just recently I went to our, you know, they've got this small coffee bar over here called CCD. They have this black chairs everywhere, and there's a black dog sleeping on that black chair. It was not even very well lit. I nearly sat on that dog because my segmentation algorithm did not work. Why should a black dog go and sleep on a black chair? It should have some sense also. If it's a different color dog, it should sleep on the black chair. It's fine. But it did not recognize that there are certain, that people will make segmentation errors, as they say. And it's not good for the dog, certainly not good for me either if I had actually sat on the dog, but somebody told me. But this is the problem. What the feature you take up to recognize a particular object, to characterize a particular object, should be different. You see the last one. The union of adjacent regions do not satisfy it. However, the rest of the chair also satisfied the same criterion of being black. Or rather, the dog also satisfied the criterion of looking like the chair. And that's where it failed. I should have looked for hair or whatever it is. That means taking a closer look, of course. So, what is it that we have similar to all the parts of a particular region, which also has physical significance, like dog? That determines what feature we should use to carry out the segmentation in the first place. It's important that we don't carry out the segmentation using a useless feature, which will not allow you to distinguish the object of your interest from the other surrounding. Okay. So there are three ways of doing it, and here is what we are showing over here. To briefly go through some of the main algorithms. And then we will see what happens. Okay. So now you see, you pick up some particular pixel where you believe the object is already there. You want to pick up the rest of the pixel. And then what you do, so you start comparing every neighboring pixel of your selected pixel, which you know belongs to the dog, and checking if it's similar enough. And if it's not similar enough, then you say this part is a different region. It's not the region I'm interested in. If it is similar enough, then you swallow it and make a larger patch now, including the first pixel and the new pixel, and then still start looking around. Every time similarity is determined by the pixels you already have, what is their mean and their statistical probability like variance, and what is the similar, I mean, what are the values of the pixel which wants to join the group, and see how it will affect the new, the mean and variance that already exists. So here is what you have, the formulas which are basically the sample mean and the sample variance of a particular region. A very bad choice of colors. Anyway, as I took care to mention, it's not my favorite.
So
you can curse this guy all you want. In fact, you won't even know because his name is not there. Fine. So you have the sample mean and sample variance. Using those two quantities, you calculate this value called t. Right. So when you calculate this statistical test, what do you do with it? You take a new pixel that is adjacent to the region you have, and evaluate capital T. If capital T is small, for example, if this new pixel y has the same value as the mean x bar, then what will happen? This whole quantity goes to 0, capital T goes to 0. That means high similarity. If capital T is large, that means y minus x bar squared is very large. It means this object is very different. So you set up a threshold and say, I am okay if this capital T comes to 0.4. And if it is less than 0.4, you will include the new pixel y in the region already growing. If it is more than 0.4, you will start a new family with that particular pixel and say, okay, let's see your surrounding pixels if they are similar to you. So this is basically the test. And here are some more details about the test. So you say, you every time you include a new pixel, you have to update the new mean and the new sample variance, the new sample mean and variance, of course. You have to do that. If you take it in. If you don't take it in, then the previous sample mean and sample variance of your region remains. So you either update it, add it and update it, or start a new region. Okay. Now, this is an example of how you used it on that picture of ours. And this is what has happened below, you can see. Now, what is wrong with this picture below? Let's see. The mouse or whatever it is, I think it looks like a semicircular object, looks like it has come out more or less properly. And you can see that spool has come out consisting of two or three regions. You can see it's more or less a mess. And maybe a different choice of the threshold small t will give you a slightly different result. But let me assure you that if you do all these things, you will never come up with a very satisfactory segmentation. You win something, you make it good somewhere, it goes bad somewhere else. And this is a limitation of region growing algorithm. Clustering is another approach where you choose in your mind that you want k different regions. So it's not very clear how to choose that number of regions you want to have. Should it be 2 or should it be 200 or should it be 2000, you don't know. So this part I am not going to get into now because it will get discussed a few slides later. So what do? You just check the amount of variation in each region. Xm is the mean of a region, xi is the pixel value of all the different pixels in that region, and you take the square of the difference. So that's a positive number under the inner summation. And then you add this over all the regions. This will give you an overall measure of mismatch between the naturally occurring regions in the image and your attempt to separate them. If you do a bad job of this, if you draw the boundaries between the regions very wrongly, then this quantity d will be very large. you do it very properly and very nicely, then D can get smaller, pretty small. And ultimately, the objective is to make D the minimum possible for the given choice of k. The whole thing, unfortunately, you are stuck with that unknown k that you should have taken. If you take just k equal to 1, for example, wow, it's very easy to do. You will just calculate the number. The outer summation is not even there. It is going to be a huge number. So you choose some k, and for that k, you play around by shifting members of the clusters. You come here, you go there, you come here, you go there, and keep recomputing this D. And somewhere you will get the best D. Say, ha, this for this k equal to 5, this is the best D I have. This is the most effective clustering segmentation that I can think of. But how do you know what k to take? That is a question that still sticks. And so we are going to look at it here. So there are various clustering algorithms you are having, and the second clustering algorithm, isodata, is the one I will be discussing in some detail. Now, there you start with a general k-means clustering, and then you try to improve it rather intelligently. What is this quantity really giving you, this D? It tells you, in a way, it gives you a number as the answer D, is proportional to the average misrepresentation of your segmentation. Correct? It gives you a measure of the average misrepresentation of your region. It does not tell you more specifically whether certain segments, certain clusters are very, very badly handled and certain other clusters are very nicely handled. It does not tell you. Maybe some clusters have got, say, the inner sum may be very large for certain regions and may not be very large for certain other regions. You can't do anything because you already selected the k, you can't increase the k now. Also, it might be the case that certain clusters have too little variation. They could have tolerated some more. So what you do in isodata clustering is this. Well, first look at this k-means clustering as you. That is the image, and this is how you are breaking it up to different regions. Which color you give to which region is not important here. The color simply says that, for example, all pixels which are blue have something in common about their appearance, right? And you have divided to 4 regions, I think. Green, blue, orange, and red. You have these 4 regions, and with 4 regions, this is probably the choice of clustering which gives you the least D. Right? Now, this is another example. Some image, the fountain comes out reasonably separately, but certain parts of the fountain do not come out very well, and that building comes out reasonably well, but those trees or whatever. Right side are getting mistaken for buildings. The trees and the buildings are both pink. That's not good. And then the water on the ground or whatever at the ground level, that is getting segmented as a separate region. So that's what getting over here. These are the ways in which k means will work. Now, and in this part, yeah, isolate. What do you do over here? You get the k-means clustering and then you try to improve on it by taking a look at each cluster individually and examining if some of these clusters are too big in the sense, not too big in size, but too much internal variation. It's like, you know, when we teach students in the class, the challenge is when you have extremely bright students sitting along with extremely the opposite student. Then you see, you try to, whichever way you try to teach, some of the students will get bored and some of the other students will be still over challenged. you don't know what to do about it. You can only decide how many people you want to bore versus how many people you want to over-challenge or how many people you want to stress too much. However, it makes sense to split them into two classes and teach one group of similar competence level separately. Teach the other group also of different similar competence level separately. Even this will not be a clean split. There will be members whom you will really have to decide, does he go here or does he go here. That will remain. But it still makes this quantity, it will still make D much smaller because you split it. However, you are doing it at the cost of increasing K by 1. You are splitting a certain region into two regions. But by doing that, you are getting a great benefit in the D. Now, having split into two regions, you will of course have to calculate the internal means and variances separately again. When you do that, it might turn out that it is not just, it is not just splitting of certain segments which occur, but when you split something and create two segments, one of those segments might be pretty similar to some other thing. So you can also merge. Splitting and merging are both acceptable. With this, depending on the number of splits you do and the number of mergers you do, you may come up with a slightly different number of regions than the original K you planned. And you should be okay with that. You can't say, no, I wanted K equal to 5 and I'm going to stick with that. K has to be a little more or less. You have to accept that that's what the situation demanded and then that what it will have to be. So this gives you some leeway to reimagine K if needed. Here is what has happened with K means clustering of that particular flower garden.
Whatever it is there, yeah, sorry. Those football players or hockey players, whatever they are.
Look at this segmentation over here.
Look at the segmentation below. Both are reasonably bad, but the one below has
made certain improvements by not splitting certain regions too finely. It's difficult to get. But the logic is that you start with a tentative K and then you fine tune the K on the basis of an isodata refinement process. This will give you a better region cluster. So with this, I am going to close on region segmentation on the basis of growing and, you know, clustering and things like that. There is one more way of dividing a region into parts, and that is to look at it as a graph. Each pixel becomes a graph, becomes a vertex in a graph, and then you connect one pixel to another pixel with a link whose weight is proportional to the amount of similarity between them. So, more similar, strong weight, high weight, great weight, less similar, less weight. So, for example, if you take page out of your notepad, fold it in two ends and just pull them apart, where will it tear? It's supposed to tear on the perforation. Why does it tear on the perforation? Because the links between this side and this side are weakest at the perforation. This is the principle that we are going to use in the graph cuts algorithm. We are going to believe that if you take a graph and pull it apart, it is naturally going to break those links which are weakest. That is, it is naturally going to break into separate parts by dividing, by cutting those lengths which exhibit maximum dissimilarity. And that's what we want. However, it is not just like holding a piece of paper at two ends and tearing it and depending on the perforation to split it into two. The fact is, you don't know which side to hold it even while pulling it. Maybe the perforation is like this, maybe the perforation is like this, you do not know. So, more precisely speaking, going out of the example or whatever I tried to give you, you really have to divide the graph in all possible ways to recognize which part breaks off from which part. And that is an extremely computationally expensive algorithm. Okay? It is more or less as expensive as calculating that D which we showed you earlier for the k-means. They are all very expensive. Do they do the same thing as each other? Probably not. It depends on the details of the image, depends on the way things are laid out in the image, depends on the data. Sometimes this method is more successful, sometimes another method is more successful. Right? Now that we are done with this and some refinements on the graph cut, we are going to detecting lines and arcs. We will come to lines and arcs later, but we will come to lines first. So, what is it about segmenting lines that we need to know? What makes a straight line? So, this is a very different story now. It is not about removing different patches, but finding out where there are straight lines in the image. There is something about straightness that applies to all of us. We even like people to be straight in their personality. But what we mean here is that a line in some sense, I mean a picture is a collection of dots, let us say, and you want to pick up that collection of dots which kind of arrange themselves in a straight path. How do you do that? Essentially, there is this Huff transform method which I will briefly describe, and that will tell you how that is done. You do what is called a voting. First, you take the image and then you remove all unnecessary information by extracting only the gradients from the image and thresholding the gradient so that all you have are edges in the image. Here is what you have. Here is an example of values. Purple ones have a very different set of values from the orange ones or your whatever pink ones. So, you want to draw boundaries between those pink pixels and the purple pixels. Let us suppose we have done this. That is the edge detection process where you use a differential operator and attempt to estimate the gradient pixels using masks. So, then you say that if the gradient is more than this, you set a threshold and say, then I will call this an edge. If the gradient is less than this, then it is just a variation of lighting or whatever. So, on this basis, you are going to use, these are all differential operators which are able to evaluate the strength of a gradient. Okay. Now, if you apply such differential operators, you will get those edges of this highest dot you are seeing over there. And here is an example different kinds of edges you will naturally get in image. The second graph is more like what you will get. The third one is showing you the first derivative, and the more effective way is to take the second derivative, because if you have a gradual transition like that, you do not know exactly where to put the line and say this is where I am going to take it into this part and this part. You cannot be sure of that. That point where you choose to make the break between the left and the right part should be the place where the transition is most rapid. That is to say, it has the maximum gradient. And that maximum gradient part is found by doing a second differentiation and looking at where that second differentiation goes to 0, second derivative goes to 0. That determines the place. That is the place that you should watch. And if you do that, you have finally got various edges like these, fine. You will get edges like, let me show you. Okay. Now, I haven't told you. Okay. So once you have the edges, I will tell you about the Huff transform, which can be generalized. The rest of the image story goes like this. Whatever I can't cover now, I can take on tomorrow, because we are going to meet again. What you do is, you have got this collection of dots in a relatively back background because you have thresholded it, and you are only looking at places with maximum gradient. For example, if you take the boundary of this whiteboard, then you will find a clear difference between the brightness of what is outside the whiteboard and what is inside the whiteboard. So you will have lots of dots along the edge, but they are still individual pixels. How do you say that this place has got a large population of pixels that are lining up? You say that simply on the basis of what I said was a vote. You take every pair of bright pixels and fit a straight line into it, y equals mx plus c. Pick up the m and the c values. The pair mc represents a certain straight line in the image. Change c values, it will translate and remain parallel to itself. You change m values, it will rotate about a certain point and give you all different slopes. Now, you make a two-dimensional histogram of the m and c values, and what does this really tell you? This tells you what are the most popular lines to be found in the image. There are lots of dots more or less in a line, then there will be several occurrences of pairs of them, which will have the same m and c. And so, in this 2D histogram, when you pick up the p, that represents an almost pure line. This is a very clever way of doing it. And you could, in principle, as I will say, show later, use this method even to pick up a circle. Why? In this case, I am saying that a line is nothing but the m and c. In the case of a circle, you can give a mathematical representation of a circle by saying it is nothing but x0, y0, the coordinates of the center, and r, the radius. So you pick up all kinds of pixels in the image and see which of them arrange themselves into circles by taking three at a time and writing an equation of the circle using fitting values x0, y0, and r into it. Now, of all possible circles, many of them will just be coincidences, but those circles which are actually there will have a huge population, will have a huge number of occurrences in the histogram. And so they will become circles. Maybe I'll stop here today and we'll cover just a little bit of it that's left tomorrow at the same time, and we will then go on to image registration. That will be the next part. And segmentation is often necessary for registration. And the importance of registration I will bring up when I talk.